We're back for Your Ears Only. I'm David Alpern.
I'm Catherine Herzog with this news quote, "Even wars have rules." That was UN official Valerie Amos after briefing the Security Council on two versions of a resolution to expand humanitarian aid in war-torn Syria. One by Australia, Luxembourg, and Jordan includes punishment for obstruction of such aid. Another from Russia did not. In Geneva, mediator Lakhdar Brahimi said the Assad regime was refusing to compromise as the opposition outlined a transitional government with no mention of Assad's ouster. Now this.
Еще во времена Холодной войны родилась такая теория сдерживания. Вот она так и называлась, теория сдерживания. Это теория, которая была направлена, и практика, которые были направлены на то, чтобы сдерживать раз.
It was 68 years ago next weekend, February 22, 1946, that the longest cable in State Department history arrived from a young diplomat in Moscow named George F. Kennan and began to shape Washington's containment policy to avoid a U.S.-Soviet nuclear nightmare. Whether or not Russian President Vladimir Putin was aware of the impending anniversary, he referenced it in Sochi last week from a Kremlin point of view. Quote, "Back in the time of the Cold War," Putin said, "the West came up with a policy of containment. It was a doctrine as well as a practical policy aimed at checking the development of the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, even today, we see occasional manifestations of that policy's lingering legacy."
The mixture of personal and professional motivations behind Kennan's cable, as well as a subsequent article about Soviet expansion that he signed Mr. X, comes through dramatically in the Kennan Diaries, just published by W.W. Norton & Company. And to talk about those motivations, Kennan's prominent role in American public affairs for the next half century, and the relevance of containment to current challenges, for Your Ears Only, we're joined by the book's editor. He's University of Connecticut historian Frank Castigliola. Welcome to the program.
Well, I'm very glad to be here. Thank you.
So where did Kennan come from, go to school, and become interested in foreign affairs?
Well, he grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. His father was a kind of an international expert on tax law, and he brought young George to Kassel, Germany, when George was 8 years old, and he spent nearly a year there going to school while his father was studying the German income tax. Another element was that a cousin of his grandfather, who was also named George Kennan, was a prominent 19th and early 20th century American who traveled throughout Russia and wrote and lectured on the Siberian exile system, the Tsar's system of exiling revolutionaries and other troublemakers in Siberia.
Talk about the way emotion combined with perception and hard reason in the policy that he began to generate.
Well, Kennan, we have to understand Kennan as a person who was at the same time intensely emotional and highly intellectual. So those two things went together and were kind of integrated in his personality and in his outlook. Kennan had very complex feelings toward Russia. He loved the Russian people. He loved mingling with the Russian people. He loved reading Russian literature. He spoke Russian language as a native. He could simply blend into the population. At the same time, he had great disdain and distaste for the Soviet government because it repressed the Russian people, and also, particularly beginning in the purges of the late 1930s, the Soviet government had a policy of isolating foreigners, including foreign diplomats who were in Moscow. Here you have Kennan loving the Russian people, yet being isolated from them by the Soviet government. And I think that kind of helped shape his outlook toward the Russian government even before World War II and then the origins of the Cold War after World War II.
Kennan later had to face the fact that what you call his exaggerated warnings about the USSR made the Cold War more confrontational and military than he originally had in mind. Talk about that.
Well, Kennan, when he wrote the Long Telegram, as you point out, 68 years ago, he was a young man who was frustrated by the fact that he felt he was incredibly talented. He knew Russia better than anyone else in the U.S. government, and yet he was being ignored. So when he had kind of this moment, Stalin gave this prominent speech in February 1946, and the State Department asked Kennan basically, you know, what is this speech all about? Kennan then wrote the Long Telegram, which portrayed in really kind of very highly emotional, graphic language, portrayed the Soviet Union as an existential threat. as a threat more serious even than Kennan believed. But he wanted to get people's attention. He'd been sending telegrams to Washington for months and sending longer reports for years and had remained an obscure diplomat. So he wanted to get people's attention. He did, far beyond his wildest dreams, because I think the long telegram came at the right moment when the Truman administration was looking for some overarching scheme, some way to make sense of how the U.S. should respond to the Soviet Union after World War II. So Kennan did get people's attention, but the nature of his warning was so extreme that people, in Kennan's view, people in the Truman administration overreacted and began to implement containment with a kind of military emphasis rather than just a political emphasis, as Kennan had wanted.
He was later...
In a way, he kind of like spawned a monster, which he then tried to deal with for decades later.
Well, he was against the war in Vietnam. He was against other interventions. Towards the end of the book, he's losing his facilities, his faculties, I should say, but still very worried about the adventurism under President Bush in Iraq and Afghanistan. Last question. Few of us will ever have much chance to impact the wider world, but Kennan's determined examination of his personal life in these diaries holds lessons for all of us. Conflicts between passion and responsibility, confronting old age, diminishing capability, death. What impressed you most in that area?
Well, I think the fact that Kennan, even, you know, he lived to be 101, and even as he saw himself literally falling apart physically, psychologically, intellectually, losing his faculties, he tried to remain cognizant as long as possible and to record what was happening and to keep himself together as long as was as possible. And that's one reason he kept the diary to the last years. It was a way of keeping himself together. So here's a person who was slipping in his capabilities, but doing so trying to be as self-aware as possible as that was happening.
University of Connecticut historian Frank Castigliola edited the Kennan Diaries, new from Norton.
Quote from the news, in terms of consumer-facing competition, you're going from zero to two times zero. That was Matt Iglesias on Slate about the proposed purchase of Time Warner Cable by Comcast for $45 billion. For the most part, they serve different geographic areas, but experts fear that the best TV and internet access could be limited to those who can afford to pay extra.
Next, the ghosts of NASCAR, for your ears only.